Today we're starting a new class. This class is called The Door to Satisfaction, based on a book by Rinpoche. I'll give a little more background on that when we start. So let's go ahead and begin with some prayers. So Anil will put those on the screen. Again, keep in mind that our prayers in Buddhism are all about working with our mind, as is everything that we're going to be talking about in this course, everything coming down to our minds, how we use our minds, and so on. So actually, the file that we'll need is not with the Heart Sutra. Should actually be the Praise to Shakyamuni Buddha. I don't know if that's in this file or not. I'm not sure if Mary gave you the right file. If not, we can just do the refuge prayer and the mandala offering, which are in there. Why don't you go ahead and go back to that, Anil? Go ahead and go back to that file, and we'll just scroll down. We'll pass the Heart Sutra, and I think that after that, if you scroll down, there will be a short mandala offering prayer. We'll just do that to begin with. Should be the next screen, I think. Yeah, there we go. So again, mandala offering is all about kind of connecting with the holy beings, the gurus, creating this sort of positive energy through making this vast, pure offering. You can imagine the entire phenomenal world transformed into a beautiful paradise, whatever that means for you. You can, you know, just use your visualization, your imagination. And then we're going to make this vast, pure offering so that we can receive the blessings, the inspiration of the gurus, of the Buddhas, so we can achieve realizations of all of the Dharma and become just like them. This ground, anointed with perfume, strewn with flowers, adorned with Mount Meru, four continents, the sun, and the moon, I imagine this as a Buddha field and offer it. May all living beings enjoy this pure land. Idam Guru Ratna Mandala Kam Niryatayami. And then Refuge in Bodhicitta, we'll do it once in English, twice in the Tibetan. And again, working with our minds, we want to cultivate the thought of refuge with the first two lines. And refuge is simply finding safe direction in the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha, especially the Dharma, these teachings, feeling that we see them as a safe source of protection from all suffering. And then the last two lines where we cultivate bodhicitta motivation, which we'll also meditate on shortly. But the idea is, again, we're here to achieve the greatest possible result, which is our own enlightenment, so we can then help others to do the same. So once in English, twice in the Tibetan. I go for refuge until I am enlightened to the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Supreme Assembly. By the merits I create through listening to the Dharma, may I become a Buddha in order to benefit all sentient beings. Sangye Chodong Soki Choknam La Jangchu Bardu Dakni Kyabsu Chi Daki Chunyan Gipe Sonam Gi Dola Penshir Sangye Drupar Shog Sangye Chodong Soki Choknam La Jangchu Bardu Dakni Kyabsu Chi Daki Chenyan Gipe Sonam Gi Dola Penchir Sangye Drupar Shok. Okay, wonderful. Thank you, Anil. Let's go ahead and do a short meditation as usual before we begin. It's always nice to begin with a little bit of focused meditation using the breath, or if you have another object that you prefer to use, you can do that. So again, we want to bring our awareness to whatever object we're meditating on. If it's the breath, again, choose a particular way to work with the breath, but try to keep your awareness there as best as you can. Remember this factor of mindfulness, which is simply not forgetting, not allowing the mind to forget and wander away. But whenever we do see that that's happened, there's no need for any judgment. We don't need to beat ourselves up. That's not a healthy way to engage in meditation or any other practice. At that time, we simply acknowledge we've lost the object. We bring the mind back to the breath, kind of being very gentle with ourselves in that regard. So we're going to do just a few minutes in silent meditation. And then I'll lead you in a short reflection to strengthen bodhicitta motivation, as well as to begin our exploration of this topic of the door to satisfaction. So again, a few minutes of silent meditation on the breath. So now let's set our motivation for today's class and begin this process by taking a look at this word satisfaction, which we use in the title of this course, which is also, of course, in the title of Rinpoche's book. What does it mean to have satisfaction? Maybe look at your own experience in this life. And have you ever really felt any deep satisfaction? They might have had fleeting moments of this. But no doubt, we've always still had some underwriting dissatisfaction, a desire to find something else, to fill in the sort of gaping hole that we have within ourselves of always wanting more happiness, always wanting to be free from suffering. Have we found that true satisfaction yet? Again, spend a minute or two investigating that from your own experience. Have you found satisfaction? What does that mean, satisfaction? So Lama Zopa Rinpoche essentially says that the door to satisfaction is practicing the Dharma. And this entire course is going to be about how do we practice the Dharma? What does it mean to practice the Dharma? But as we know from previous teachings in this tradition, the greatest level of satisfaction that we can find is by dedicating ourselves to others, by thinking that we are here for the welfare of all beings. Of course, we are included within that, but the focus moves away from just me, myself, and I, to the vast number of beings that are other, all of these others that I want to cherish most deeply. I want to hold them as the most important, and to try to hold the awareness that you're here in order to accomplish their welfare, in order to help them to find the satisfaction that they seek. And through that, you will find your own satisfaction. The greatest happiness we can experience will come about when we dedicate our lives fully to others, as Rinpoche says. So try to hold that awareness, that motivation for being here, thinking that you're here to accomplish the welfare of all sentient beings through working on your own mind, practicing the Dharma. And through this, recognizing that this will result in your own deepest satisfaction, as well as that of all beings. Okay, wonderful. Good to see you all again today. So we're starting this new course, and when I talked to Mary about what to do after finishing the course on the six perfections, this idea had been bouncing around in my mind, because it's been since, the very first teachings that I had in the FPMT tradition were in January of 1996, which is 25 years ago. So essentially, I thought, well, why not revisit the very first teachings I received, which were actually from Venerable Robina. I was living in San Francisco, and I actually happened to move in that fall just before to the same street where Seichen Ling had been relocated about a month earlier. And so I had been involved with the Dharma through Rigpa, Sogyal Rinpoche's organization, for a few years, having gone on retreat with Sogyal Rinpoche in 1993. But I was still looking, still searching for something. His organization, as good as it was at the time, it was mostly focused on him, and he only came through the Bay Area maybe once a year. It was very hard to kind of find ongoing teachings. I was mostly going to people's homes, and we would discuss the book and meditate a little together. Really not, the type of thing that FPMT offers at all, So when I realized this center was right down the street for me, and I walked by there every day going down to the BART station to take it downtown to work, I saw one day a poster with Venerable Robina's face on it, and a friend of mine who had been studying Dharma for a while as well, she said, oh, you have to see Venerable Robina. She's pretty amazing. So I went ahead and signed up for the course, and it was every 2 weeks, I think, on a Thursday night. And that was my introduction to Venerable Robina as well as to Lama Zopa, because we began, this was just a course focused on this book, The Door to Satisfaction, which I think had just been published many years before that. Actually, I can look at my copy of it. I have the old copy that I bought at that time. And it was published in 1994. So anyway, it had appeared, and Venerable Robina, of course, was one of the editors. And so she decided she would do some teachings on it. So as I said, that was kind of my introduction to her. And of course, she immediately hooked me. The book hooked me as well. And I met Rinpoche later that year for the first time. And of course, everything else is history. But this book, again, when she introduced it, she essentially introduced it as being mind training, Lojong. And we know this from our previous studies, again, here at Sechen, or at Thupten Norbuling, that there are a lot of teachings that are involved in what we would call Lojong, or mind training. In fact, we could say everything the Buddha teaches is mind training. But this text in particular is renowned for a few things I'm going to share shortly, which are essentially, you know, Rinpoche's own discovery of this text and his finding that it really revealed a lot to him about what it really means to practice Dharma. So as I said in the motivation today, you know, it's called The Door to Satisfaction, but we really have to look at what do we mean by this word satisfaction. You know, our own experiences of satisfaction are very temporary. We might, you know, eat a good meal and feel satisfied. We use that word, right? But is that satisfaction really lasting? Before too long, we're hungry again, we crave some additional food, maybe even we want to have that meal again, or whatever it was that we enjoyed. We're never really satisfied. And of course, this is one of the big problems of samsara that we need to see for reality. This is one of the faults of samsara, as are set out in the traditional Lam Rim teachings, is that there's always this sort of undercurrent of dissatisfaction. We never really find something within samsara that fills the bill. And of course, the answer to that, as we looked at a little bit in the meditation today, is to discover the satisfaction that can come through practicing the Dharma, through entering that door, the door of Dharma, that will then reveal the way to attain true satisfaction. This text, as I said, is mostly focused on, well, what does it really mean then to practice Dharma? And how are we going to practice Dharma given the lifetime that we have, the amount of time we can put into our spiritual practice, all of those sorts of things that might be feel somewhat limiting. But nonetheless, you know, there's no better time to start our practice of the Dharma than now. So let me share a few slides. I do have a little slideshow I put together for today. I don't know how much I'm going to use slides going forward for this course, but nonetheless, I think it's kind of a nice way to open up this course, because today we're going to talk about a number of topics. So as I said earlier, this will be based on teachings that Rinpoche gave in this book. I would really encourage you to read the book if you haven't, or if you have read it previously. Like, I don't know that I've actually sat down and read it from cover to cover until now, since 1996, when Venerable Robina was teaching on it. It's a book on my shelf that I pull out occasionally to get particular passages from, but I haven't really gone through it in its entirety. And it's not that long of a book, but essentially it includes, as it says in the second bullet point there, Rinpoche's commentary on points from a Tibetan text that the title of it is loosely translated as Opening the Door of Dharma, the Initial Stage of Training in the Graduated Path to Enlightenment. Which is essentially a collection of advice from many of what are known as the Kadampa Geshes, which were compiled by the Tibetan yogi Chenga, Lodro Gyaltsen, usually just referred to as Lodro Gyaltsen. And these are the dates that are indicated in the book. When you go to Lama Yeshe Wisdom Archives, they have slightly different dates for him. But he was kind of living right around the time of like the tail end of Lama Tsongkhapa's years, as well as into that next generation of followers that came from Tsongkhapa. Essentially, this book is, again, a collection of advice, but it was this author, again, was a disciple of one of Lama Tsongkhapa's two spiritual sons, as it says there, Kedrup Rinpoche. Kedrup Rinpoche is, again, kind of in that same time frame. Obviously, Lodro Gyaltsen lived a bit beyond that. Lama Tsongkhapa himself passed away in 1419. I think most of you are familiar with who Lama Tsongkhapa is. He's the founder of our tradition that we practice in the FPMT, what's known as the Gelugpa tradition. And the other spiritual son of Lama Tsongkhapa was Gyaltsep Rinpoche, whose times are, again, very similar, right in that period of time. I always find it interesting, you know, that while all of this was going on, all these amazing teachings and thoughts of these accomplished masters and very informed beings, that, you know, at the same time in the Western world, it was a pretty dark time, you know, part of the Dark Ages, I guess, or certainly the Middle Ages of those 1300s, 1400s. When you look at the West, I don't think there was really much to hold a candle to what was going on in Tibet at the time. So this is, again, speaking to who this teacher was that wrote this text. Those of you who are familiar with Tsongkhapa and the Lama Tsongkhapa Guru Yoga, this is the image that's often used when you visualize. You have Lama Tsongkhapa and his two spiritual sons. On the left side of the screen is Gyaltsep J. Gyaltsep Rinpoche is usually kind of having a peaceful sort of demeanor to his face. And then on the right side is Kedrup J. And Kedrup Rinpoche, again, has a bit more stern look to him. But these two sort of are renowned scholars, both of them, wrote a number of commentaries and amazing texts themselves. So again, our author, Lodro Gyaltsen, was a disciple of Kedrup J. So very close to, you know, the Tsongkhapa's lineage in terms of that regard. But in 1974, Rinpoche says, he was doing retreat up near Laodo. You know, he is the reincarnation of the Laodo Lama. There is a whole book on that, on the Laodo Lama. But essentially, Rinpoche was in this cave, and he mostly found Nyingma texts. Those of you who know what the Nyingma tradition is, that's actually the tradition that Sogyal Rinpoche was primarily involved in. It's the oldest of the four traditions in Tibet. It was formulated around the 7th, 8th century teachings of Padmasambhava. It's still around as a very active tradition. And Rinpoche was a Nyingma Lama in his previous life. That was his main practice and main lineage. So he went into the cave that his previous incarnation had used, and he mostly found these Nyingma texts, but among them he found this text that is much more general, not as specific to Nyingma practice. Might even call it sort of Rime. Rime is sort of the non-sectarian branch of Buddhism. But nonetheless, the author was somewhat in the Gelugpa tradition. Lama Tsongkhapa didn't say, I'm establishing that tradition. It all formulated after he passed away. But essentially, these teachings are very much in line with the Gelugpa approach to how to practice the path to enlightenment. So Rinpoche says at the very beginning of the text, this text describes the initial stage of thought transformation or mind training. In other words, the first thing to practice if you want to practice Dharma. And this is kind of a, you know, very inviting title, right? You know, I think the whole concept of like, well, where do we start? Where does Dharma practice actually begin? And even though many of us have had many, many Dharma teachings, it does seem that there still might be that gap between what it is that we are professing to do and what it is that we actually should be doing. These words, mind training or thought transformation, as they're sometimes translated as, again, I mentioned the Tibetan for that earlier, it's Lojong. Lo means mind, and jong has different connotations. Sometimes it means to purify, sometimes it means to train. There are different ways that you could talk to that word and give it a different, slightly different meaning. But essentially what we're talking about in regard to the transformation process of working with our minds is to use everything that we meet as an opportunity to deepen our Dharma practice. Of course, in the most advanced Lojong teachings that we see in the Mahayana tradition, we have the way of practicing so that everything we meet, especially our problems, our difficulties, our suffering, becomes an avenue for developing our compassion for others, developing our understanding of karma, and so on. So the Lojong tradition, we can't say that, you know, it was begun in Tibet as a genre of teachings. It certainly was something that came from Lama Atisha, who came to Tibet about 1,000 years ago. But there was another 1,500 years prior to that, where the Buddha was essentially teaching mind training. Everything the Buddha taught is mind training. And that's because the mind is really the key. The mind is the secret. I remember there was this wonderful quote that was shared at the last Light of the Path retreat in 2017, because for some reason, with the people that were there and with Dr. Nick Roybush, who again is going to be teaching later this week on the spiritual teacher, but essentially Dr. Nick was leading the retreat, so he gave people a lot of opportunities to share their memories of Lama. And one of the things that really touched me was Karuna Katen sharing that Lama Yeshe was talking to him once, and he was saying, you know, all these Westerners, essentially this is the gist of what he said initially, he said, all these Westerners, they come to Nepal and India expecting some kind of magic. And he says, but they don't know the mind is magic. And I think that that really sums up the whole of Buddha's teachings, is that our minds are actually magic. It's through our minds that we actually create our suffering. It's through our minds that we create our happiness. So we're going to be talking about that and unwrapping that and really getting to know what that means in terms of the teachings Rinpoche gives on thought transformation, mind training in this text. But again, everything the Buddha taught is to transform our minds, to change our minds from our unenlightened state to our enlightened state, which is all a thought process, as well as then eventually going beyond thought to know things in a much more direct way to create the most lasting transformation of our own minds. So this idea, again, of how do we even know if we're practicing Dharma? And that's one of the big things we're going to be looking at in this text. How do we know if we're doing that thought transformation, if we're actually working with our minds to engage in that process of transforming them from our unenlightened state to our enlightened state? So I'm going to have a little bit more quotes from Rinpoche that come from the very beginning, get us kind of going. Whoops, sorry. So Rinpoche says, and I think this was even in the advertisement, the publicity for this course, he says, only when I read this text did I come to know what the practice of Dharma really means. During all the years of my life up until then, I had not known. Practicing Dharma is usually regarded as reading scriptures, studying, memorizing, debating, saying prayers, performing rituals, and so forth. And a lot of us, of course, engage in many of those things. And I have to say, Rinpoche often encourages us to engage in those things, right? But nonetheless, are they enough, or is there something more that is needed? Is there something deeper that comes as a preliminary step before all of those things take on new meaning? Because again, all of these things that are mentioned, you know, reading scriptures is certainly important, or reading texts, Dharma texts, what have you, studying them, even memorizing them to some degree is helpful. They do that in the monasteries to a great degree. Debating, well, we don't engage in so much debate in our Western centers, but in the traditional monasteries, they debate and learn most of the material through hours and hours of debate. You know, in the West, we try to discuss things, to engage in some sort of deeper investigation of the teachings with others. We certainly say a lot of prayers. We perform a lot of rituals. We have our pujas and things like that that we do. We engage in a lot of stuff that we might think is practicing Dharma. But is it necessarily practicing Dharma? You know, this is the question Rinpoche kind of investigated and realized through reading this text, that perhaps he hadn't been practicing Dharma. You know, and of course, the gist of this is that it would be really a shame if we got to the end of our lives, whenever that happens. One of the topics we're going to be looking at as part of this course is death and impermanence. But if we got to the end of our lives and we realized at that point, oh my gosh, I haven't really practiced Dharma at all. I've done all those things. I've recited a lot of texts. I've said a lot of pujas. I've done a lot of prayers. I've, you know, read a lot of Dharma. But have I really practiced Dharma? Now, that really is the key question, and we're going to be working with that again in today a little bit, but especially the next session or two, where we look at how a lot of the things that we would ideally need to overcome actually become obstacles if we don't really address them, if we don't really see them clearly for what they are. And therefore, we aren't practicing Dharma because we still have the more coarser forms of attachment involved in so much of what we do. You know, attachment's going to be, or desire is going to be, a big topic in regard to this course. I think when it comes to some of the delusions, it's a little bit easier to see them, but attachment has this way of getting into our minds and guiding our actions so much that it's very hard to pick it apart and to see it for what it is. And of course, we have to do that. If we don't do that, then we're going to continue to just simply create the patterns for the same sorts of unsatisfactory experiences that we've had. Okay, so let's go back and see what else Rinpoche says on the basis of this comment, you know, again, kind of recognizing that he didn't find out what it really meant to practice Dharma until he read this text that, again, is the source for the book that he wrote. It was only when I read this text that I found out how to practice Dharma. I was very shocked that all my past actions had not been Dharma. When I checked back, all those past years of memorizing and saying prayers were not Dharma. From all those years, nothing was Dharma. Of course, Rinpoche found this in 74. I think he was born in 1946, so he wasn't even, you know, 30 years old yet. You know, so luckily he found this text. But of course, we can also, you know, many of us have the belief that Rinpoche was already a very highly realized being. He's putting all this forward for our learning, for our examination of what does it really mean to practice Dharma. You know, how are we going about our process of engaging in these teachings? And is it true Dharma practice? So he then goes on to talk a little bit about what the text demonstrated for him. He says, this book, again, the text itself, Opening the Door of Dharma, is not fully translated into English, at least that I'm aware of, but there are some passages from it in Rinpoche's book. But he says, Opening the Door of Dharma by Lodur Gyaltsen again describes mainly impermanence and death, the shortcomings of desire, the obstacles created by what we know of as the eight worldly dharmas or eight worldly concerns, which is a big topic we're going to go into again mostly next week. Reading this text was very helpful. It showed me that, like molding dough in your hand, you can definitely turn your mind whichever way you want. It can be trained to turn this way, that way. Of course, the gist of it is that we have already trained our minds to move in a particular direction through our countless lifetimes prior to this one. You know, we have a habitual way of working with things that have led us to this pattern, as I was saying in the motivation today, of seeking satisfaction in the external things in our world. You know, and this is a pattern that if we look at, we certainly want to look at ourselves first, but if we look at the world around us, we see how much this is the case for everyone, right? People are so invested in needing the external things to be the way they want them to be in order to feel some measure of happiness and this fleeting satisfaction, you know, whatever they call satisfaction in their lives. And of course, with the pandemic that we've been experiencing now for a year, we see how much we've had to loosen our control of all of that, right? Because we can't control it, because things in our life are not necessarily the way that we would ideally like them to be. We can't go the places we want to go. We can't do the things we want to do. We can't see the people we want to see. We have so much of this that we have invested in the external needing to be a particular way for us to have some measure of happiness in our lives. But of course, that is not the answer. We've been doing that in every single lifetime since beginningless time, and it hasn't produced any real satisfaction. Instead, we keep creating the same pattern of looking for all of those things to satisfy, and we get disappointed by them. I mean, we don't see it often, and most people don't see it. That's the shame. That's the real suffering that exists in the world, is that most people simply keep going back to those things again and again and again. And they don't see them, as it's often pointed out, to be like drinking salt water to quench your thirst. You never really gain the satisfaction that you're seeking. You go to all of those things, those sense objects, various experiences, all the things that we tend to rely upon. And you walk away just wanting more. You never really get to the end of all of it. And there's all these quotes from like sutras and stuff that if you were to pile up all the things, you know, all the bodies that we've had, all the things that we've consumed, think about all the food even you've consumed in this lifetime with some attachment, some desire to gain some happiness from it, you know, it would be a humongous pile. And all of that was for naught. I mean, we needed to nourish this body, but all of the attachment we generated through the food that we eat, through the music we listen to, through the sensual experiences that we have, you know, through our senses, these are, you know, just meaningless in the end. They don't really produce the satisfaction that we're seeking. So what this text again is pointing to is the idea that we have to find a deeper way of attaining satisfaction, which means changing how we relate to things, changing our minds. Because if we don't change our minds, we're going to keep doing the same thing over and over again. And it'll be like that, you know, saying we have in the West of insanity is doing the same thing over again and expecting different results. Well, this is what samsara essentially is. Every lifetime we do the same thing over again and we keep getting the same results. So at some point we have to wake up to that and say, I'm tired of these results. I'm tired of what I'm getting. I'm not getting any real satisfaction from samsara. I need to change my mind. I need to change what is going on from this side rather than change what's going on outside. And of course, as I said, this is how we live our lives, right? We try to get the external situation into a perfect place. If I can get the perfect job with the perfect home and the perfect partner with the perfect pets and the perfect, you know, salary and the perfect this and the perfect that, I'll line it all up and it'll all be in place. And then I'll be there and I'll attain happiness. You know, it doesn't happen, right? First of all, it's almost impossible in samsara to get everything lined up like that, right? It's a bit like whack-a-mole. You know, you get one down and you go, okay, I got the perfect job now, but then, you know, another problem, you know, comes up and then you have to deal with that and get that in place. And then sometimes then the job goes away and then whatever, everything is constantly changing. Of course, this is, you know, a fundamental truth that the Buddha taught as well, is that we can't rely upon these things in part because they are impermanent. They're transitory. They're not something that we can go to time and time again and always be assured we're going to get the satisfaction we desire from them. But they don't even provide a lasting form of desire of satisfaction. They continue to simply feed our desire. We get into this junkie mentality. Again, to quote Venerable Robina, she didn't have this quote when I was learning from her in 1996, at least I didn't hear it, but she says, we're like junkies born into a world of junk. And this is really the truth. You know, we have this craving mind, this mind of attachment and desire that is continually seeking a fix. You know, we want a fix from this, we want a fix from that. And we just keep going after these things and we keep getting our fixes, but we don't get fixed in a more lasting way. We only get that temporary fix, just like a junkie. And then we need another hit. You know, we need something else to get us to be happy again. Well, there's a happiness we can experience. And I, at times I may even be quoting from some teachings Rinpoche gave at the Light of the Path retreat that have been put together in a course that I did teach at TNL some years ago. It's part of the Living in the Path series. It's called The Happiness of Dharma. Well, what is the happiness of Dharma? The happiness of Dharma is when we begin to experience the freedom that comes from investing in our minds as opposed to investing in our external experience, to begin to let go of all of that. You know, and Rinpoche says, first of all, you'll just notice how much money you save, you know, which is kind of a clever way of pointing it out. But, you know, we do invest a lot in producing or getting all these things that we think will produce some sort of satisfaction in our minds. But they, again, don't last. We get something new and it's kind of nice for a little while. And then we need something new to, you know, fill in that gap. We never really find anything that's lasting. So there are a lot of truths that we're going to be talking about as part of this course that Rinpoche is simply pointing to, but to give us the opportunity to know a deeper form of happiness, a deeper form of satisfaction, because otherwise, you know, it will continue to elude us. We'll keep doing the same thing lifetime after lifetime after lifetime. And as I said, at least maybe whatever age all of us are, you know, gathered here today, we will find it now and find out the real way of practicing Dharma and the real way of assuring that we use this life meaningfully before it's too late, before death comes and we won't have any more opportunity with this life. Hopefully we've created the causes for a good rebirth, but who knows? You know, these things are all a bit indeterminate at this stage. So again, as Rinpoche says, like molding dough in your hand, you can turn your mind whichever way you want. You know, we've turned our minds in this habitual way of being guided by our desire, continually being chasing after all these objects, all these things, experiences. And even if we're not working with the external objects, we're sometimes just remembering things or planning things. We do a lot in our minds to create these feelings of pleasure. But those also are very fleeting and temporary. We have to find more lasting ways to develop a deeper satisfaction. Yeah. So then he says after that, as Kirti Sentrab Rinpoche passed away quite a few years ago, he was holder of the entire Holy Buddha Dharma. You know, he said all the teachings of the Buddha, which are called the Kangyur. We have a set of the entire Kangyur for Tupten Norbu Ling that will be in the new center. Was in our previous one, but it'll be all in its own house there. Shelves that'll be are designed specifically for it. And the commentaries by the great Indian pandits, which is called the Tengyur. Those also we have a copy of for our center. All of that, all the teachings of the Buddha are to subdue the mind. All of these teachings are mind training, thought transformation. All the teachings of Buddha are to transform the mind, to subdue the mind. We didn't get a chance to say that little verse today in the prayers, but there is that verse that we repeat every Sunday when we get together, right? Do not commit any non-virtuous actions. Perform only perfect virtuous actions. Subdue your mind thoroughly. This is the teaching of the Buddha. Of course, the first two are the very basic teachings that we all have to learn, and karma is going to come into play in this course as well. But essentially, to stop doing those things that are harmful to ourselves and others, because that only creates negative karma, which induces more suffering. And to start doing the things that are virtuous, that lead to happiness for yourself and others. Because if that's the fundamental starting point, is that we all don't want to suffer and we all want to be happy, well, we need to stop creating the causes of suffering. We need to start engaging in the causes of happiness, of well-being. But even those two things are somewhat limited. You know, we can gain a lot through simply practicing in attendance to those two lines. Stop committing the non-virtuous, perform only the perfect virtuous actions. You'll gain some good results within samsara, and you'll have some nice experiences. You know, we won't have quite as much of the grosser forms of suffering. But have you found real satisfaction yet? That is the starting point for the Buddha's teachings, but it's not the final point in a sense, unless we take that second one to mean going to the full length of what it means to practice virtue, which is the third line, to subdue our minds thoroughly. You know, our own minds are the creator of all of our actions. Our own minds do create actions through the thoughts that we have and what we do with our minds. But essentially, subduing our minds means to completely reduce and eliminate eventually all the negative tendencies, all the thoughts that are what we would call our afflictions, our delusions, our obscurations, and to completely develop and cultivate to the greatest degree all the positive tendencies, which of course are our virtuous states of mind, you know, compassion, loving kindness, wisdom, you know, all of these need to be developed to the greatest possible degree. What does it mean to subdue your mind? That's essentially it, you know, to identify what is negative and to remove it and to identify what is positive and to cultivate it. So one of the things, again, that I just alluded to a little bit a little while ago was one of the most prominent negative states of mind that we have to subdue is this mind of desire, of attachment. You know, in fact, when the Buddha taught the Four Noble Truths, which most of you know, and I may allude to it a little bit later today, but this is the most core teaching of the Buddha that is taught throughout all the Buddhist traditions. And essentially, it entails four truths that can be seen in their clearest way by the noble ones. That's why they're called the Four Noble Truths. The Aryas, the noble beings who have a superior insight, can actually see these for really what they are. And the very first one, of course, is the truth of suffering, of dukkha. We use suffering as a translation for it, but by dukkha, again, we mean this entire unsatisfactory experience that we're having. And of course, there are varieties of it. There's the more obvious ways that it's unsatisfactory when we have pain or suffering. But even those things that we experience that are some measure of happiness don't really lead to any true satisfaction, as we saw earlier today. So this is because we are caught up in this pattern through the force of our own karma and delusions. We just keep doing the same thing over and over again. So we call it cyclic existence. You know, it is a circle. We just keep circling from life to life, never doing anything to break out of that. Well, there's a cause to that. That's the second noble truth. And when the Buddha first taught that, he said in the very first sutra that he gave, the first discourse, which was some 49 days after he became enlightened, he essentially said that the source of all of our suffering, all of our dukkha, is desire, is craving. Now, again, there's a deeper root to that. You know, we discussed this a bit in the previous course when we looked at the wisdom of emptiness and, you know, how we develop that perfection of wisdom, which cuts at the root of samsara. The Buddha didn't teach that deeper error in his first discourse. He said the most direct cause of your being in samsara is your desire, your craving. So when we talk about these afflictions that I was alluding to and what we need to remove from the mind, one of the things that is the hardest to get to but is the most essential is to really recognize, what is this desire? How does this desire play out in our lives? How does it cause all of our problems? Why is it behind all of the, what we, you know, the Buddha said in his first teaching, it's the cause of all of our unsatisfactory experience. So again, this is something we're going to be talking about more and more as we go through the course, but I'm pointing it out right now because essentially when we talk about this process of removing what is negative and engaging in what is positive, one of the most important things we have to identify and learn to remove and diminish, you know, through our practice is this mind of desire, you know, which is operating a good portion of our life. I always call it the default mode. Because when we wake up from beginning our day, it's always about, oh, what do I need? What do I want? I, you know, I need to go to the bathroom and I need to get some food and I need to do this and I need to do that. Because we're always craving something, always wanting something. Now, some of it admittedly is a biological need, but nonetheless, it's frequently driven. All of our actions seem to be driven by that desire for pleasure, for happiness. We keep going chasing after it like a moth to a flame and not recognizing that this pattern simply keeps us in samsara due to the factor of attachment, that craving, that desire. And we'll pick that apart, you know, as we go through this course to get to know it even better. Just so you know, the rest of the noble truths, if you haven't had teachings on those two that we just went through, the truth of dukkha and the truth of the causes of dukkha, are kind of our current experience. The other two are our future experience if we do practice the Dharma, if we do open to the Dharma through this door that is being taught in this text. And that essentially would be the truth of the end, the cessation of our dukkha and all the causes of it. You can have an end to it, the Buddha said, without a doubt. I sometimes point out that if he just gave the first two truths and there wasn't an end to it, it would have been pretty mean of him, right? You know, pretty cruel. Guess what, folks? You're all suffering and you're suffering even worse than what you thought you were suffering. And that's because you have crazy mixed up minds. And he'd be like, oh, good luck with that. I hope you know, find something and that it works out for you. Instead, he went on to say, folks, you can end it once and for all. And that's through practicing the path, the true path that leads to that cessation. So the Four Noble Truths is a wonderful schema for looking at everything the Buddha taught, because essentially all the teachings are derived from that and give us greater advice as to how to work within that format of understanding what we are involved in and what it could be if we actually put the energy and attention into changing things. But this is what we mean by then, again, working with our minds. It is our minds that get us into the situation of dukkha, this unsatisfactory state. It is our minds that will get us out of it, that will actually help us to cultivate true peace, will help us to even go beyond our own solitary peace to attaining Buddhahood for the sake of all beings. So, again, is quoting Kirti Sensha Rinpoche, who points this out, and again, something I've alluded to even earlier. So within the book, there are, like, I identified kind of, I don't know what, 8 topics that I want to focus on throughout this course. I've got about 6 sessions to do this. The very first one's highlighted because this is what I want to kind of cover today then, is to really know how to practice Dharma by recognizing this perfect human rebirth and practicing the Lam Rim. So some of today will be a little bit of a repetition for those of you who know the Lam Rim, but nonetheless, if you don't know the Lam Rim, it's useful. But even if you do, it might be good to frame what we're going to do in this text and this course with regard to the Lam Rim. This is how the text by Lord Gelson starts out, is with recounting some of the basic Lamrim teachings that came from Lama Atisha, and Lama Tsongkhapa taught extensively. And of course, then the author of our text, Lord Gelson, you know, found through his being connected to Rinpoche, or I'm sorry, to Lama Tsongkhapa through Kedrup Rinpoche. So then the second topic we're going to go into next week, which may take us even more than one session, and that's because it's such an important topic within this text, giving up this life and cutting off desire, and especially the eight worldly dharmas. And then remembering impermanence and death, which, as was mentioned just a few slides ago, is one of the key topics within this as well, that I think is so important for us to use as an impetus for us to engage in wholehearted Dharma practice. And then a few more, working with karma and motivation, this chapter on subduing the mind that we've already touched on a little bit, but that's going to go a little bit more into that, cherishing others, which of course moves us up into the Mahayana Lojong teachings, finding no self to cherish leads us into the emptiness teachings. I'm not sure I'll do a whole lot on those since I just taught on emptiness pretty extensively. And then he has a final chapter just before the dedication chapter that's having no choice but to practice Dharma. So I hope we all arrive at that point. I mean, whether I'll get to everything on this list and discuss it all in depth, I'm not sure. But nonetheless, hopefully by the end of this course, you will have learned what it means to practice Dharma and recognize that there's no choice but to practice Dharma, that if you really desire happiness, if you really want satisfaction, if you really want to be free of all suffering, there's no choice. You have to practice Dharma. Okay, so this is just to give you an idea then of how the text kind of unfolds. So this is the very beginning of Lodro Gelson's text that is quoted. As I said, there isn't a translation of the entire text in English that I'm aware of. Maybe someday it will be translated. I don't know that I could do that. I don't have very good knowledge of Tibetan, but... It starts with a homage, as most texts do. Our author says, "May the teaching of the Buddha, origin of all sentient beings' benefits and happiness, flourish. I am requesting that it develop extensively. I am requesting that all sentient beings experience great bliss." So he's kind of opening up by saying that he recognizes the great value of the Dharma, you know, the Dharma that he has come to learn and appreciate through his own experience, and that he wants the Dharma to flourish and develop throughout this world. This is one of the best prayers we can make, right? To think that the Dharma could flourish and grow throughout this world, that all beings could find the Dharma in their lives to some extent. And maybe to some degree, they're finding Dharma in their own way through their own spiritual traditions, but we want them to find the Dharma that leads to that last line, all sentient beings experiencing great bliss. You know, what will lead to that result? What will lead to that complete satisfaction that is the ultimate state of spiritual development, Buddhahood, and the great bliss that beings experience when they achieve that state? Only the Buddha Dharma. Only the Buddha Dharma teaches the complete method for accomplishing that goal of Buddhahood. So I'm not going to say a lot about these homage verses, but I think they're kind of nice that Rinpoche put them in his book. Then there's a homage that's made to the Guru. "I prostrate to the stainless lotus feet of the Guru, who is inseparable from all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas of the 10 directions, and take refuge in him or her," or them, if you want to be non-gender specific. But again, gurus don't always have to be male. Many, due to a patriarchy to some degree that's existed within Buddhism, many of the spiritual teachers are male, but it's has changed a lot and will continue to change. So that's not to be, again, gender specific with regard to who can be a guru for us. Then it says, "By paying homage to the lotus feet of the Guru and relying upon them, I receive all perfections. To the Guru deity, I bow with respect and devotion." So I'm going to take it off slide here just a little bit to talk about the Guru, because this is the first topic of the Lamrim, after you kind of learn the history of it and what the Lamrim's intended for, and maybe even they teach you a little bit about the preliminary practices and things like that that you need to engage in to have a really rich practice. The first topic you actually meditate on is what we often call guru devotion, but we could call it simply the reliance upon a spiritual guide. The recognition is that if we are embarking upon something that we've never undertaken to this degree before, you know, maybe we have found the Dharma here and there in these past lifetimes, but we never got as serious about it as what we need to get in order to really accomplish things. We need a guide for this. My gosh, if you go to a place, a part of the world, just on a visit, and you don't know much about what's going on, it's helpful to have somebody there who can be a guide, a tour guide for you, or at least you rely upon some people who know what's going on in order to say, yeah, you want to go up that street and go to the left and then go around the corner and you'll see it at the back of an alley or whatever. I mean, people who can give us advice from their own experience. Even in worldly things, we need this, right? Nobody learns a craft, a trade, completely on their own. If they learn it, you know, not from a live person, they at least learn it from a book, you know, but most of the times you're taught a trade by somebody who's quite accomplished in it, giving you their expert advice. Well, it's the same on the spiritual path, and why should we expect it to be otherwise? This reliance upon a guide is so essential. Lama Tsongkhapa himself says this is the foundation of all the good qualities that we develop, is our dedication and reliance upon someone who can perform that role for us. And ideally, many people who can perform that role, because we might have to rely upon more than one, but at least one. And of course, this is where a lot of people begin their path, is kind of trying to find someone that they can refer to, that they can see as a guru, and develop that guru-disciple relationship. But be very careful, be cautious in all of that. And know that, again, in this course, I'm not going to go into all the Lam Rim teachings about what we're ideally looking for in a guru and so on. All of these things are set out in books like Liberation in the Palm of Your Hand that most of you should already be quite familiar with. But ideally, once more, we are looking for somebody who we have some confidence that they do have the knowledge that we're seeking. They have already demonstrated some practice of the Dharma that we can then see for ourselves that it works. It's sort of they're a walking advertisement for the Dharma that they teach. And that they also, of course, have more Dharma knowledge than what we currently possess. And then we have other qualities like their compassion, their, you know, patience. That are very important for us to learn from them, right? You want teachers who actually care about you and your spiritual development. You want people who will be patient with you in your developing your own understanding of the Dharma, so that you aren't, being beaten up if you aren't achieving things so quickly, you know, that they have some ability to be with you and tend to you, even in the midst of the craziness of trying to change our own minds and so on. So we need a spiritual guide. That one little line that was mentioned at the very beginning of that slide, let me put it back on so I can refer to it. It says, I prostrate to the stainless lotus feet of the guru, who is inseparable from all the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas of the 10 directions, and take refuge in the guru. So what does that mean? Again, this is one of the hardest teachings perhaps to get our heads around. But nonetheless, you know, again, through repeated study and practice of this, I think we can come to that conclusion that essentially the gurus, the spiritual guides that we have in this world, are the ways that the Buddhas are helping us and other beings. Now, if we are setting out on this path, as this whole entire course is about, as almost everything we present at TNL is about, everything in the FPMT is about, we want to achieve the state of Buddhahood, right? We are setting our sights on this goal of attaining Buddhahood so we then can, in that state, benefit other beings. Well, that should lead to the question, well, how am I going to benefit other beings when I become a Buddha? When I become a Buddha, I hopefully can appear in some form that they can relate to, that I can talk to them, I can give them Dharma teachings, I can be with them, I can counsel them on how they are, you know, proceeding and so on. Well, how would I do that except by taking form? If we talk about a Buddha's mind being this fully developed mind that did the task I mentioned earlier, completely removed everything that is negative, completely developed everything that is positive, well, how would we relate to a mind? If there was the Buddha's mind in front of us, and they say the Buddha's mind pervades everywhere, just like in the, you know, theistic traditions, they say God is everywhere. Well, the Buddha's mind is everywhere, but the Buddha's mind needs to take form to help us, right? Otherwise, how could I know the mind of a Buddha if it's just this mental energy that's out there? It has to be in some embodied form. That's why the Buddha's experience involves that component, you know, that physical appearance that will help us to relate to the teachings, to hear the teachings, to receive that personal advice, to have someone who can sit down with us and, you know, teach us, what have you. So we need a physical form in order to achieve any measure of practice on this spiritual path. As I said earlier, we need to rely upon a guide. And if the Buddhas are the ones helping us, well, then they need to appear in a physical form. So this is, again, an ideal way to look at our gurus. It's not required right from the beginning. In fact, it's not even until tantric practice that it becomes really essential that we look at our gurus as Buddhas. But nonetheless, entertain the idea. It makes some kind of sense, right? If we think about it and say, well, you know, Buddhas are trying to help me. They're trying to help every one of us to become enlightened. Well, how are they doing that? You know, how are they appearing? Are they our politicians? Are they our corporate leaders? Are they, you know, the everyday person on the street? Well, we don't know. They could be all of those. But what's the most effective way to help others? To be a spiritual guide for them, to appear as a guru, to appear as His Holiness the Dalai Lama, as Lama Zopa Rinpoche. And of course, they have an ordinary appearance. That's the way they have to appear to us in order to talk to us, in order to relate to us. But this is, again, an idea that I'm just planting the seed for, if you haven't already entertained this idea, but it's a very important one on our spiritual path, to begin to see our gurus as inseparable from the Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. They are the essence of that same enlightened energy that is appearing in our world to help us on our spiritual path. And then we rely upon them. We say, okay, you know, we have these beings that we find, that we know are reliable, that we can put our trust, our confidence in, and then we hold on to them and follow the teachings they give us, you know, recognizing that we are still somewhat blind to the nature of things, and that they have already opened their eye of wisdom and therefore, you know, can be a perfect guide for us in our state. So I'm not going to go into, again, great depths on the teaching on the guru. Know that there's a wonderful book of teachings from Lama Zopa that's a bit long, but it's a really amazing teachings called The Heart of the Path, about seeing the guru as a Buddha. And you can entertain this concept at any time in your spiritual path. But as I said, it becomes even more pressing further along when we get to the tantric teachings. But nonetheless, it's interesting that our author of this text sets that out as the very first thing to contemplate, to think about the guru and the guru being inseparable from the Buddhas, and then to say, you know, that we are going to take refuge in the guru. We're going to find that that is our true refuge. And it actually is a wonderful way to see the gurus, that they are the beings that we do put our faith and confidence in, right? To even greater degree than the Buddha. The Buddha isn't here in front of us, whereas Lama Zopa, His Holiness, whoever it is that we see as our gurus, they're there in the flesh and blood. We can talk to them. We can relate to them. We can get teachings from them directly. So this is just something, again, that I wanted to point out, because this whole introductory session today is all about the stages of the path. And the foundation of everything we develop on the stages of the path is our willingness to kind of put our spiritual practice in the hands of the guru, to help the guru to give us the advice that we need. And essentially, that's what this whole course is to use Lama Zopa Rinpoche's advice given in this book as a means to help each and every one of us to move in that direction. Whether or not Rinpoche is your guru, you can still begin to see it as some way that the gurus, the Buddhas, are trying to get through these hardened minds of ours and actually help us to develop some realizations, some qualities. So it's a little bit after 11. Let's go ahead and take our break. So let's say at 11:15, I have 11:04 here. So I'll ring the bell. Again, if you leave your speaker on, I'll ring the bell and you can take your time, do what you need to do, and I'll see you at 11:15. Okay. Okay, welcome back. Yeah, my camera sometimes goes out of focus a little bit. I just tried changing the setting on it so that it's, I'm hoping that might help a little bit. But sometimes when I toggle back and forth between the screen sharing and coming back, it goes out of focus a little bit. But yeah, if anyone has any suggestions, I have a webcam, Logi, webcam. It's the same one that we have at the center that we were using at the center when we were over on 2nd Street. It's not the exact same one. It's the same model. All right. Excuse me. allergies starting. Let's go ahead and go back to the text. And again, we're working with this little bit of introductory bit that Rinpoche did translate and put into the first chapter of his book. So the next thing is what we generally call a promise to compose and an exhortation to listen. Often the texts in Tibetan or Indian traditions, they have this as part of them after the homage. They make this assertion that they're going to, what they're going to compose and that they're going to do it. And then they encourage others to listen to it. So it says, with compassion for those who seek to practice Dharma from the heart, I will reveal here how to practice the holy Dharma. I will reveal the teaching that enchants the learned ones adorned with the Buddha's teachings, as well as the commentaries written by the pandits and the guru's instructions. Listen respectfully and one-pointedly. So essentially, he's just saying that he's going to give us advice on how to practice the Dharma, which again is what the entire book is essentially about. How do we make sure that what we are engaging in is in line with the Buddha's teachings, the Kangyur, again, that I mentioned earlier, as well as the commentaries by the great Indian pandits, the Tengyur, as well as the guru's instructions that he's received, which are always the heart advice that the gurus give as to how to practice these teachings. So that's enough on that. Now he goes on into the other of the preliminary topics for the Lam Rim, which is taking the essence of this perfect human rebirth. And here he says, from the holy mouth of the precious Guru, essence of all the three times Buddhas, at this time when you have received a precious human body with freedom and richness, you must take the essence as much as possible. To do this, examine the difference between your mind and an animal's mind. I'm going to share some more of what Rinpoche says in a moment on this, because his comments are really quite nice. But I just want to, again, talk a little bit about what it means to have this perfect human rebirth. As I said, these two topics are what we often call the preliminary topics, depending upon a guru, having that relationship with a guru that is strong, that is allowing you to receive the advice of a guru in a very personal way so that you actually develop on a path to enlightenment. But then recognizing, of course, the human rebirth that we currently possess, that is the perfect opportunity for practicing Dharma. And he says here, just simply compare your mind to the mind of an animal. And of course, when we look at the animal world, we see that they're very limited in what they do with their minds. Their minds are primarily driven by some seeking of comfort, some avoidance of danger, you know, trying to do everything they can to get the food that they need, to be safe from the elements, to not have to worry about the prey that will prey upon them, what have you. You know, most of our experiences with animals are our pets, and our pets have a relatively cushy life when it comes to all of that, because we feed them, we take care of them, we keep them inside when it's cold or when it's too hot. You know, they don't have to worry about so many of these things. But that's essentially what an animal's mind is mostly involved in, is just the immediate needs of this life. And of course, everything we're learning in this text is that we have to look beyond that. We have to loosen our attachment to that, our preoccupation with all of that, because this human life has actually so much more potential. As human beings, we have an intellect that is unbelievable, that we can use to investigate these teachings, that we can use to change our minds. Without that human intellect, very, very hard to make any progress. That's why what are called the lower rebirths, the states of an animal or the hungry ghosts, the hell beings, these are not favorable states for spiritual development. Why? Because we are under the control of those more immediate states of mind that are simply trying to avoid suffering at the moment, to get happiness at the moment. Nonetheless, a lot of human beings, unfortunately, live their lives with that same preoccupation. And this is something that we're going to be tested on in regard to this text, is to really examine to what degree are we still treating this very perfect human life as if it were no different from an animal's life, only being preoccupied with what will bring immediate satisfaction, that temporal satisfaction, and not use it to attain deeper satisfaction. So a human rebirth is, they talk about it in terms of, and that was in the quote I just shared, having these freedoms and richnesses. What are we talking about there? We're talking about the freedom that we have of not being born in those unfavorable states. you know, not being even reborn as a human who could have potentially some impairment to their mental faculties, or as a human that is in another realm of this world where, you know, they don't have access to the Dharma, another part of this world, or we could be a human being that's not interested in the Dharma. You know, so we have many conditions that we're free of. Moreover, we are endowed or have these, you know, richnesses that are the things that we bring into this human life, or we create in this human life, that make us very connected to the Dharma, that make the Dharma capable of influencing our minds. If we have some measure of faith in the Dharma, if we have a good, strong intellect that is investigating the teachings and trying to understand them, if we rely upon, you know, teachers around us and the teachings that we've been given that are in our world due to all of the lineage of gurus that have kept these teachings alive, we have all these things that have lined up that make this life very, very rich. So we are free from some unfavorable states, and we are rich or endowed with some amazing opportunities. So what do we do with this human life? I mean, how do we make sure that it's no different than an animal's, when in fact our minds are quite different from an animal's? We can do so much more with our minds than what an animal can. And of course, animals are the only beings we have any other sort of interaction with. All the other realms that the Buddha taught, perhaps, you know, they intersect with ours to some degree, but we don't really see them. We don't interact with them and have any idea of what's going on for them. So from this quote that Rinpoche shares from Lodro Gyaltsen, from this root text, Opening the Door of Dharma, Lama Zopa then goes on to kind of give his commentary on that. He says, examine an animal's mind. An animal thinks, I want to be happy. I don't want to be cold. I don't want to be hungry. Of course, it doesn't use those words, right? I don't think our cats or our dogs, you know, actually have that language. But those are the impulses, the thought processes that they are engaged in, right? That, ooh, that'll bring me happiness, you know? Ooh, that'll bring me suffering. I'm going to avoid that. You know, they simply are reacting to things through their own limited thought processes. But nonetheless, you know, this is indicative of the limited capacity of an animal. It says, Rinpoche then says, if you think of nothing other than that, you are no different from an animal. It is important to take the essence of this body. And in order to do that, you should not cling to this life. You know, this is the, again, one of the more important passages perhaps in this entire text. In order to take the essence of this body, this human body that you currently possess, you should not cling to this life. In other words, don't get preoccupied with all the things that make this life, in the end, they waste this life, but they simply make this life solely concerned about those fleeting pleasures, and make this life, therefore, not capable of producing something that is more lasting, a deeper satisfaction that we can find beyond those temporary experiences. Otherwise, we're simply using this life in the same way that an animal does. Now, as I said earlier, when we go through these sorts of passages, it's very easy to look at others and say, oh yeah, I can see how everyone, you know, all these people in the world are doing this. But it's very important that we not do that as much. If we do that, we generate compassion for those beings. But the main advice is to look at yourself. To what extent are you still living your life in the way that an animal does? Simply having these impulses throughout your day of, oh, that'll bring me happiness, I'll go over there, you know, after that shiny object, and then, oh, that'll give me suffering, so I'm just going to avoid that and do whatever I can to create different conditions. Most of our lives are spent like this. I think it's something that, again, will become more evident as we look especially next week at these eight worldly dharmas. Then he goes on to quote the great Bodhisattva Shantideva in A Guide to the Bodhisattva's Way of Life, where he says, and this is usually in verse form, but this is how Rinpoche's translation is just in prose. This perfect human body, qualified by freedoms and richnesses, is extremely difficult to find. If one does not attempt to obtain the benefits of this human body now, how will one receive another in the future? He's kind of pointing to the very least thing we can do with this human body. Again, this human body came about through its own causes and conditions. We might look at it and think, well, many people have human bodies. You know, it mustn't be that rare of a thing to create a human body. But if we look at the various realms of existence, the Buddha says it is actually very, very rare to be born as a human. I think we know this here in New Mexico in the summer, especially when all the bugs come up from out of the ground, right? All the ants and everything on a single little plot of land where maybe two or three, maybe a few more humans live, there are thousands of little insects and critters, right? You know, we know that that's so in so many parts of this world, and the vast number of beings are actually in the oceans, where you have just, you know, all of this water that covers, you know, a good portion of this planet, and all of these little microbial lives and fish and what have you, all these various beings that are living there. It actually is quite rare to be reborn as a human. And it came about through its causes and conditions, the most important one being your engagement in the past, a prior life, of some good morality. And then, of course, other causes and conditions that led you to have this human existence. So the import of this human life currently is that we have to at least create the causes for another rebirth like this. And of course, that means we have to let go of our attachment to this life. And if we are going to create things even beyond just a good rebirth, we have to let go of our clinging to this life. And this is the point that Rinpoche is going to keep driving home as we go through the various points of this text. So Rinpoche goes on to comment on Shantideva's thing, where it says, how will one receive another in the future, another rebirth, if we don't, you know, obtain the benefits of this human body? He says, asking how you will receive another perfect human rebirth in the future implies that unless you attempt to obtain the benefit of this present human rebirth, you won't achieve another. And why do you need to obtain the benefit of this perfect human rebirth and get another? Because you do not want suffering, and you do want happiness. It is not the case that you wish to have suffering and do not wish to have happiness, right? I don't think there's anybody who's going to sign up for that and say, you know, I don't want, you know, happiness, and I actually would like to suffer. We're all driven by that fundamental desire to be happy, to not suffer. And there's nothing wrong at that level of that simple impulse that all beings have. What is wrong is the way in which we go about achieving that. And as Rinpoche is pointing out here, we actually need to use this human life in a meaningful way if we don't want to suffer and if we do want happiness. Why? Because otherwise we will do the opposite. We'll only create the causes for suffering for ourselves, and we will continue to have happiness evade us. It simply won't manifest in our future lives. So then he goes on to say, with this perfect human rebirth, we have the opportunity to create the causes to have happiness and avoid suffering. It's just, again, whether we use this perfect human rebirth for that purpose or not, or whether we simply, again, go through this life as no different than an animal and simply perpetuate patterns that lead to more suffering and never result in any real peace or happiness. Happiness and suffering, again, he's repeating a little bit of what I've already talked about today, but I think it's worthwhile putting Rinpoche's own words here. Happiness and suffering come from your own mind, not from outside. Your own mind is the cause of happiness. Your own mind is the cause of suffering. To obtain happiness and pacify suffering, you have to work within your own mind. The workshop is within your mind. Now, some of you, I think, are taking the Mind and Its Potential course that Shankha is teaching on Mondays. And, you know, that's the essence of that course, really, is to get people to become more aware of the fact that the workshop is within our minds, that it is up to our own managing of our minds as to whether we create the causes for happiness or whether we create the causes for suffering. And this all is, again, the secret of the mind, the most important thing that we have to learn from Buddhist teachings. And then he goes on to say what I also alluded to earlier, that you need to eliminate the mental factors, the thoughts that bring suffering. You need to recognize and understand well those wrong ways of thinking, as well as the right ways of thinking that bring happiness. You know, when people first hear these teachings, and I'm guessing that most people listening to this today, you know, all of you here in the Zoom room as well, as well as most people who listen to it as a recording, will have heard this idea before. You know, will have been exposed to the thought that it means working with our minds to obtain happiness, to be free from suffering. But once more, does our behavior accord with that? How do we actually live our lives? And this is really the gist, again, of Rinpoche's book, is to help us to take a hard look at how we're actually engaging in what we call the practice of Dharma. As I said, it was quite telling, you know, Rinpoche himself to point that out as a lesson for all of us, that he felt that up until that point in time when he read some of the teachings we're going to be looking at, that he didn't think he was practicing Dharma at all, that actually what he was engaged in was doing a lot of his Dharma activities, you know, all of these making prayers, reciting texts, doing all these various things, rituals, but he was doing them with a worldly mind. He was doing them with an animal's mind. Again, I'm not pointing fingers at Rinpoche and saying anything negative. This is the gist of what he was saying as a lesson to all of us to take a look at our own minds. To what degree are we going about our spiritual practice with a mind that is simply concerned about the happiness of this life, simply attached to feeling good about who we are or the praise that we might get or to whatever it is that we obtain through our spiritual practice in this life and not really even looking beyond this life? So I think he's, again, pointing out a lot of these things so that we take a very good look at ourselves and recognize perhaps where there is some gap between what we are trying to do and what we are actually doing. What is it that we, you know, how can we fill that gap, minimize that gap so that we actually have the thoughts of real practice while we are actually practicing? So, all right, then he says, you know, you do this process of reducing the negative and enhancing the positive by relying upon a correct teaching, such as the Buddha Dharma. In the workshop of your own mind, by listening, reflecting, and meditating, you try to eliminate the negative attitudes, which bring suffering, and to increase the positive attitudes, which bring happiness. What's pointed out in the very middle of that, where it says listening, reflecting, and meditating. I think I touched on these in the Perfection of Wisdom. These are the three forms of wisdom that we can develop. We develop wisdom through listening to the teachings, the Buddha Dharma. And that's what we're doing today. All of you, you know, kind of hearing Rinpoche's words, my words, Lodur Gyaltsen's words, and taking those in at that level. Already there's some measure of wisdom that has been cultivated by hearing words that are more in line with truth, more in line with the Buddha's path to how to achieve that result. But then it's not enough to simply listen to them. We have to reflect on them. We have to think about them, contemplate them. That's what most of us are doing in our meditation currently because we don't have a strong meditative focus. Instead, we sit down and we, you know, use our kind of crazy minds to look at these teachings as best as we can, to kind of stay focused on them, to penetrate into them, to analyze them, and see if we can actually find some truth in them that goes beyond just the words that we've heard. That's an important part of the process. But until we develop finally the third wisdom, the wisdom of meditation, which is where we do have that more focused mind that I described in the previous course, the mind of calm abiding that is able to remain single-pointedly on whatever object we're investigating for as long as we wish. Well, until you get to that level of mind, you're not going to be able to have the strength of meditation that is being required here. But that's how we actually change our minds in a much more lasting way. But it all begins with just hearing the Dharma, thinking about it, and then eventually meditating on it at that much deeper level to actually change the fabric of our minds. But that's the workshop again. Yeah, that's where we take these teachings in and actually do the work. And that's the means by which we will accomplish this process, eliminating the negative attitudes, increasing the positive attitudes. So then he goes on to say, and this is going to be the rest of today's class, I may not even be able to finish it, but he says, if you understand Lam Rim, the graduated path to enlightenment, the stages of the path it's often referred to, you know the benefits you can receive from this perfect human body. So again, Lam Rim, Lam means path, Rim means graded or gradual stages, the idea being that it is a gradual development of your mind towards enlightenment. And it's generally indicated in three levels. The preliminary to all of it are the two topics we talked about earlier. Dependence upon a guru, reliance upon a teacher or teachers who can play a key role in our spiritual development, and then recognizing how we have to take the essence of this perfect human rebirth. So he goes on to then spell out these in a very brief way. The first benefit you can receive from this human, perfect human body is happiness of future lives, which means receiving the body of a happy migrating being, such as a god or human. Generally, we try to gear our practice towards obtaining a human rebirth because of the ideal nature of this human existence. But nonetheless, God is included in there because there are these other upper realm beings where you do have a lot less suffering. And in some occasions, you can receive teachings in those rebirths. The second benefit, the second way that we achieve something meaningful from this life, is liberation from samsara, release forever from the bondage of karma and delusion. Again, that's why the Buddha taught the Four Noble Truths, was so that people would wake up to their situation and want to be free from it once and for all, not just gain a good rebirth, which is the first step, but essentially in the second step, to develop the mind that wishes to obtain liberation, that wants to be free from the unsatisfactory nature of samsara. And this again is a theme that we will see throughout this text as well, that being an important part of all of our spiritual processes, is to develop true renunciation, to move away from the patterns of suffering towards the patterns that will lead to real happiness and peace. But there's a goal beyond that, a benefit beyond that. The third benefit is attainment of the non-abiding sorrowless state, the state of Buddhahood, full enlightenment, as it's described here, which is essentially the cessation of the two types of obscuration. The afflictive obscurations, what he calls here the disturbing thought obscurations, which are all the crazy delusions that we have in our minds that can be completely removed. But then we have even subtler obscurations that keep us from being a Buddha. And I'm not going to go into all the detail on that. I'm actually teaching on that to some degree on Wednesday night in the class on grounds and paths. But these are the two things that need to be removed to attain what is called here the non-abiding state of samsara, sorrowless state. I'm sorry, state of nirvana, sorrowless state. Non-abiding nirvana means to be free of samsara, but to not kind of check out into a sort of solitary peace, to continue to be engaged in the world. So Buddhas attain this non-abiding nirvana, which allows them from that enlightened state to benefit others. And of course, that is the goal that we are always trying to remind ourselves of, which will make our life the most meaningful. So Rinpoche then says, it is these three benefits or levels of happiness that Shantideva refers to in the verse I mentioned earlier, and that he means we should obtain with this present perfect human rebirth. In order to receive these three benefits, we need to follow the graduated paths of the three levels of capability of the three capable beings. So before I share those in a little bit more detail, know that again, this is kind of Rinpoche's answer to this question of what is it that we actually can achieve? What is true satisfaction? As I said, we did a little reflection in the meditation this morning, the experience that we've had with satisfaction has not really been true satisfaction. You know, we've had these temporary experiences of feeling, like I said, satisfied after a meal or going to a concert and hearing a wonderful performance and going, wow, that was a really great concert. But, you know, did it give you any lasting satisfaction? Has it produced anything that is meaningful in terms of your well-being, your ultimate well-being? And in fact, the other thing that we're going to be investigating is, moreover, has it simply perpetuated the desire, the craving that we've been dealing with since beginningless time, and in that way actually become a cause for us to move backwards as opposed to forwards? So these three happinesses, these three satisfactions that we can obtain through this human rebirth are the gist of the Lam Rim. It's what the entire Lam Rim is about, is to help you to know at least the satisfaction of a good rebirth following this one. Lose your preoccupation with the pleasures of this life, but set your goal on getting another rebirth like this. Why? So you can have another basis for practicing the Dharma. Secondly, to be free once and for all from the entire process of this cycle of existence, this insane cycle that we are on of just continuing to do the same thing over and over again. Third, to recognize that everyone else is in this exact same situation, the same predicament. Therefore, we should want to go beyond just our own solitary achievement of that, to be dedicated to the welfare of others, to help them to achieve that. And for that, we have to attain this non-abiding sorrowless state, this non-abiding nirvana. We have to be able to continue to be engaged in the world in the form of gurus, again, which is kind of bringing it back full circle to what we talked about earlier, that this is actually how those beings who attain full enlightenment enact the welfare of others, is by being in this world, helping others in that way. So let's go through a very brief review of the LAMRIM. If we have to do a little bit more of it next week, we can do that. But I think most of you have had LAMRIM teachings, so I'm not wanting to make it too overwrought. But nonetheless, it's part of our text. So you'll see that there are some passages from Lodro Gyaltsen as well as Lama Zopa on these three paths, there's three levels. The origin of the LAMRIM teachings, of course, is the Buddha's teachings, but they were structured into what's known as the LAMRIM by Lama Atisha. Again, he came to Tibet at invitation of the king of Tibet at the time to teach the Dharma, to reinvigorate the Dharma in Tibet, because there had been a lot of degeneration since the early days of Buddhism in Tibet. And Lama Atisha wrote this text, Lamp on the Path to Enlightenment. And the second verse says, understand that there are three types of persons because of their small, middling, and supreme capacities, their capabilities. I shall write clearly distinguishing their individual characteristics. So again, this verse isn't in the Lama Zopa's text, but nonetheless, I thought I would point it out so that you have the awareness that, again, this is derived from this great Indian master, Atisha, who came to Tibet about 1,000 years ago and left this amazing text behind that is the foundation for everything we study in this Gelugpa tradition. So here's a little chart I put together. Again, the preliminary topics that help you to have the basis for engaging in the LAMRIM are relying upon the guru and recognizing this perfect human rebirth, and of course, taking its essence, seeing that it is essential that we do something meaningful with this rebirth. Then we go on to the lower capable being, and again, I'll show that slide again with regard to each of these stages. From our text, from Lodro Gyaltsen, he says, anyone who performs dharma or worldly activities with the desire for the body of a god or human in the next life is called a lower capable being. All actions done with that motivation are the cause only of samsara. You will still continue to have a samsaric experience. You will continue to be reborn through the force of your karma and still have your delusions and so on. But you will get a good rebirth. Why? Because you practice dharma or your other activities with that wish, dedicating and, you know, keeping your mind as focused on obtaining a good rebirth. Again, letting go of our attachment to this life and at least being focused on the next existence. So this is the verse from Atisha's text. Know that those who by whatever means seek for themselves no more than the pleasures of psychic existence are persons of the least capacity. And of course, by this, you could divide that into two. You could say there are some who seek only the pleasures of this life. Well, they're not even practicing dharma per se. And that's something that we touched on earlier, but we'll also go into more next week. But the pleasures of cyclic existence also refers to a good rebirth, you know, to have a rebirth as a god or a human, one of these ideal rebirths where you don't have quite as much suffering, gross suffering that you have to deal with. So that's the person of least capacity. That's the lowest level of dharma practice. You have to be at least engaging in that for it to be considered the practice of dharma. So the first, Rinpoche says, the graduated path of lower capability is described in the following way by Lama Atisha in Lamp on the Path to Enlightenment. He says that if the motivation is to cut off clinging to this life completely and achieve the body of a happy transmigratory being in the next life, one should, with the realization of the shortcomings of non-virtuous actions, renounce the 10 non-virtues and practice the 10 virtues. That's all of the teachings, the essence of the teachings on karma that we have in the person of lower capacity, that portion of the stages of the path. This person, he says, who protects karma and lives in morality with the aim to receive just the happiness of future lives, is a lower capable being. This is what Rinpoche's terminology for it is. Even back then, he likes to say this is the lower capable being. It has the least capacity in terms of what they can take on, but it is the most important that we at least have that. And again, this is what we're going to be examining is, do we have this? As it said in that previous verse, have we cut off clinging to this life completely and determined that we are going to use this life to achieve the body of a happy migrator? So if we do that, we will have practice the person of lowest capacity, the stages of path for them. They have, again, the motivation to attain a favorable rebirth. That's highlighted a little bit on the left. The highlighted topics that are over here under lower capable being are first to recognize the inevitability of death and the reality of impermanence, which of course is what we're going to see as well in this text. Very important teaching that makes sure that we get on the Dharma path, at least make sure that what we do is Dharma practice. Then, of course, the lower rebirths I mentioned earlier, that would be the outcome if we didn't practice Dharma, that at the end of this life, when death does happen, we could end up in an unfavorable state. Therefore, we need something to protect us from that, and that's where we develop refuge in the three jewels. We find that the Buddha, the Dharma, and the Sangha, and also even our gurus to a great degree, are what will protect us from that through their teachings, through the ability for us to then take those teachings in and practice them. And the most fundamental teaching that is necessary to achieve a good rebirth, as well as all the results on the path, is the teachings on karma. To understand that, as was mentioned earlier, we are the creators of our own happiness, the creators of our own suffering. Therefore, we have to take charge of it by avoiding the non-virtues, the 10 non-virtues that were mentioned earlier. Again, they're all set out in detail in the Lam Rim texts, as well as avoiding in the 10 virtues and doing everything we can to maintain good morality by, again, letting go of this life and being mostly focused on how do we create the causes for a good rebirth. All right, that's the first of these three levels. The text then by Lodro Gyaltsen goes on to say, anyone who wishes to be liberated from samsara and practices Dharma with aversion to all samsaric activities is called a middle capable being. All such actions are virtuous and are the cause only of liberation from samsara. Whereas for the lower capable being, all of their actions with that motivation only resulted in samsaric experiences, continuing to be in samsara, though having a good rebirth. Here, all such actions are virtuous and are the cause only of liberation from samsara, because that is one's motivation. To be free of all samsaric discontent, dissatisfaction, to be liberated once and for all. So Lama Atisha, in his text, he described it this way, those who seek peace for themselves alone, turning away from worldly pleasures and avoiding destructive actions, are said to be of middling capacity. You know, they want that solitary peace. They've turned away from samsara, renounced samsara, all the pleasures of samsara, and they avoid all of what is destructive and engage in what is wholesome in order to accomplish liberation, the peace for themselves, or what we would call solitary peace or individual liberation. Rinpoche on this says, with the second, the path of middle capability, one sees samsara in its entirety. These aggregates, meaning this body and mind, caused by karma and delusion, is only suffering. Is only unsatisfactory. Because they are contaminated by the seed of delusions, these aggregates, this mind-body complex, causes the future life samsara. You know, we see very clearly that as long as we don't transcend all of this, as long as we don't try to move beyond that, we're going to continue to have future experiences in samsara. We just keep going from life to life. They might be good ones if we practice the lower capable path, but nonetheless, we're still going to be in samsara. So therefore, as long as we haven't removed those contaminations, that will be the case. So seeing samsara as complete dukkha, complete suffering, like being in the center of a fire, one turns one's back on it, fully renouncing it. There's not the slightest attraction to samsara, to samsaric perfections. This is a pretty highly evolved state of mind, you know, and we again point to those who are on the path of individual liberation and see it as inferior to some degree to the Mahayana. But this is quite superior to what we just looked at, right? Because it's somebody who is determined to not have to continue to experience the round of existence, to be free once and for all from all of that. The aim of beings of middle capability is to achieve their own liberation from samsara, from the bondage of karma and delusion. And the method to achieve this is the practice of the three higher trainings, morality, concentration, and wisdom. Again, these three higher trainings are what will get you out of samsara when practiced to the greatest degree. On the foundation of morality, you then go on to develop deep concentration, and then you unite that with a wisdom that is knowing how things actually exist, and that will break you free from the root delusion of ignorance, as well as all the other delusions that are a part of the process of creating karma and continuing rebirth in samsara. So again, I could say a lot more about that, but this is an introduction, and we are going to get into some of these topics in the next five sessions in terms of what will help us to see very clearly the need to work with our minds to develop these trainings so that we can be liberated from samsara. That is encompassed by that middle capable being on the left-hand side, person of middling capacity, has the motivation to attain self-liberation. The middle capable being essentially studies and practices an awareness of suffering, what the suffering is in its fullest dimension, some of which I alluded to earlier today, as well as the causes of suffering, karma and delusions, especially delusions, because they are what's driving us to create karma that kind of keeps us bound in samsara. And then the three higher trainings I just mentioned, which are the means of attaining liberation from suffering and its causes. All right, so then we go on to the third, the great capable being. Again, this is introductory for today, just to help us to get a grounding in what we're doing here in terms of this work. Anyone whose actions are done, not just to achieve self-liberation, but for the liberation of all sentient beings, is called a great or supreme capable being. These actions are the cause of achieving enlightenment. By that we mean full enlightenment, not just one's own liberation, but the state of Buddhahood. These three beings are distinguished only according to the mind. Once more, it is the mind that determines whether your actions result in a good rebirth, your actions result in liberation for yourself, or your actions result in enlightenment. It's all up to your own mind. You know, it doesn't matter, again, what activities you're doing. You can be doing reciting Mahayana texts, but if you're doing it only with the motivation of the attachment to this life, it's not even Dharma practice. But this is pointing out, again, how you can develop your mind in this gradual way to take on a deeper and more vast and more important goal through these three stages. So let's look at the final one a little bit more. This is, again, the verse from Atisha. Those who, through their personal suffering, truly want to end completely all the suffering of others are persons of supreme capacity. This, of course, is what we said our motivation for every one of our classes, and we try to emulate this idea. But whether our actions are truly creating the causes for that, we'll be exploring. It has a lot more to it than, you know, just simply saying these words or having a, you know, a simple thought. We have to actually do a lot more to change our actions to create these results. So Rinpoche says in regard to that passage from Lodro Gyaltsen, now the third, the person of higher capability, completely renounces cherishing themselves and instead cherishes other sentient beings with the aim to achieve full enlightenment for their sake. And this again is a big topic that is in this text as well that we will get to a little bit later, because it is the highest motivation where we want to even stop this mind that habitually is self-centered, self-focused, and begins to move our awareness to the welfare of others. The method to achieve this is the practice of the path of what is called the causal vehicle, the paramitayana, in which one practices the six paramitas or perfections. Sound familiar? That was what the previous course was on. These six perfections of a bodhisattva: giving, patience, morality, enthusiastic perseverance, concentration, and wisdom. So this is the path that one achieves on the sutra side of it, the causal vehicle in which you engage in those six paramitas, as well as some other activities, and you eventually achieve Buddhahood. On the basis of this, the person of higher capability, a great capable being, also practices the resultant vehicle, Vajrayana or Tantra. So in order to get to full enlightenment, you practice with those six perfections, but you have to accompany it with the practices of the resultant vehicle, the Vajrayana. It's called that because we think about being a Buddha now, having that resultant state in the moment, rather than creating all the causes for it and eventually achieving it. Again, I'll maybe say more about that later, but essentially, the path that is normally taught in the Lam Rim is only up to the point of Tantra. Tantra itself is taught as an entirely different engagement in the stages of the path because it has its own teachings that support your spiritual development. Nonetheless, it's within this higher capability. So what we see then in terms of our chart is that the person of great capacity has the motivation to attain Buddhahood for the sake of all beings. That leads to them being a great capable being that has practiced bodhicitta, the six perfections, also practices the four means of gathering disciples, which I mentioned in the previous course, this way of helping to ripen the continua of other beings. And of course, they practice tantra, which is normally, again, not taught in the traditional stages of the path texts because it's an additional whole corpus of study and practice, but it's rooted in this motivation. To become a Buddha for the sake of others, but to do so through the tantric path even more quickly. All right. So in our texts, it says, just like Rinpoche said, these three beings are distinguished only according to the mind, meaning it's up to, once more, to our thoughts, our motivations, our intentions to create the causes for any of those results, or to simply create the causes for more suffering. All of these depend once more upon the mind. So let me take it off screen there because we're getting close to the end of the hour. Anyone have any questions or comments on what I discussed? I realize it's very introductory. Doris, yes.
As usual, a word question.
Sure.
The use of the word capability and capacity. Mm-hmm. Seems more like it's just motivation. So why such emphasis on capability? It's not intellectual capability, is it?
Well, it's not intellectual in the sense of just having understanding. It's obviously more tied into, as you said, motivation and the courage or conviction that it takes to extend oneself to that degree. I suppose it comes to some degree from the word muni, which is used like in Shakyamuni, the name of the Buddha who gave us these teachings. Muni simply means someone who is able, who is capable of relieving the sufferings of others through imparting the Dharma to them. And so there is this idea of kind of becoming completely able or capable. And what we see this as is a stretching of our capacity, stretching of our ability to take on more and more. Sometimes they even talk about these as being burdens, but I don't really like that terminology so much. But at the very first level, we want to at least take on the burden of being dedicated to creating a good rebirth. Most people, again, in this life, in a human life, are only going to be capable of just tending to their needs in the same way that Rinpoche is saying, like an animal does. And maybe for many of them, that takes a lot already. That's a lot of capability or capacity that just takes to work every day to try to care for their loved ones, to make sure there's food on the table, to do all these things. And they can be doing those activities with a different mindset, but nonetheless, most people are simply trying to put their attention into satisfying the needs, the desires of this life. To extend your capability, your capacity to take on the welfare of your future lives is already stretching yourself a little bit. To stretch yourself even further to think about, well, I'd like to really just stop being reborn once and for all. I mean, stop having these unsatisfactory experiences in samsara, even if I end up as a human. Look at all the sufferings in the human world. There are tons of them. We've been experiencing many of them throughout our years, however many years you've been here. So we know that it's not a satisfactory result, but nonetheless, to get to that place does allow us, we do have to stretch our thoughts to think about we are capable of doing more. And then we get to the capability of a great scope being, that's the place that we ideally want to be. But that does take, again, a lot of stretching of our thoughts and our intentions, our motivations, our mind. So it could be worded certainly as three different levels of motivation. And that's what I put on the chart on the left-hand side is what is the motivation of those beings. But it all has to do with what we feel capable of accomplishing by virtue of moving away from the self-concern that we start with towards eventually other concern and being willing to dedicate our lives to the welfare of others. And that does take, again, some kind of increasing our capacity, increasing the capacity of our hearts, our minds, to be able to eventually take on the welfare of all beings. So I don't know if there's, you know, other explanations, but I think it is very much tied into this idea that even in the mantra of the Buddha, which is Tayata Om Mune Mune Maha Munaye Soha, it means the person who is able, or able, kind of that the Buddha is an able one. And then Maha Munaye, the greatly capable one, the greatly able one. Well, you know, to get to that feeling of capability or capacity, we do have to stretch the mind through these stages of development. If we don't, then we're going to still continue to be very narrowly focused, initially just on this life and then on just the next life, but still my own experiences, then freedom for myself from samsara, but which is still my own experience. And then to think we have the capacity to go beyond that, to extend our sense of concern to include all sentient beings. So I see it, you know, a very useful term, a useful way of looking at it, though, again, I don't know why it's chosen per se, other than what I explained. So does that make some sense?
Yes. And yeah, as usual, going back to either the Sanskrit or the Tibetan really makes it click for me.
Good, 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 good. Yeah, and I think the other idea, you know, that we need to keep in mind in all of this is that we do all have this sort of hidden capacity. And that's kind of, in a sense, what we mean by our Buddha nature. Every one of us has this jewel within us, which is the ability to develop our minds to that degree. Venerable Rabina, she often uses, when she does her teachings on mind and its potential, she talks about an acorn. I don't have an acorn here, but we've all seen acorns, right? You know, that little seed type of thing with the little crown on top of it. And you can do lots of things with an acorn. I mean, maybe as a kid, you would paint little faces on them, or, you know, paint their little hats different colors or whatever. Or you could even put them in a slingshot, right? And shoot them at, you know, hopefully not critters, but shoot them at a target or something. Or maybe you could do, you know, all sorts of creative things, make a huge art piece of a gluing them to a canvas or whatever. I mean, there's no extent to what sentient beings could do with acorns, right? But what's the potential of an acorn? What capacity does it have? What is its capability? It's to develop itself into an oak tree, right? That's what its real capacity is. And of course, that requires that it has to be put in the ground and nurtured, make sure there's enough nutrients in the soil, that there's enough sunlight and water and everything that is needed to tend to it so that it grows into an oak tree. Well, it's the same with our minds. Our minds have the capacity, the capability of becoming fully enlightened. That's what a mind is, a phenomenon which has the ability to attain complete enlightenment. It's not a rough, like a specific definition of mind, but it's a way of talking about mind. So that also points to capability, capacity. And where most beings, again, are blind to that, they think that it's very limited, that this mind is quite limited in what it can do. They don't see this Lama Yeshe, I pointed out earlier today, that the mind is magic, that we can actually do something amazing with this mind. But we have to stretch our capabilities. We have to look beyond what we think we're limited to see that we actually can achieve more and more, and eventually the most that we can achieve. So, any other questions? Thank you, Doris, for that. Any other questions? I didn't see anything in the chat box. Have I stayed clear through this? In focus. I'm not clear in terms of what I'm saying. In focus, this second half, because I know I think this might be the mode I need to put it on. I think it's a little bit wider screen too, which shows you more of my room that I'm in here, for good or bad. But anyway, I'll try to maintain that so that I have focus in terms of the picture. All right. So again, hopefully you can obtain a copy of the book. It's also on Kindle, all those sorts of, you know, e-services, so that you can read it there. It's not a very long book, but it's got so much amazing, precious advice in it. And I'll try to, again, use some passages, maybe not as much today in terms of slides, but I want to use some of the passages that are from the text by Lodro Gyaltsen that Rinpoche comments on. There aren't that many of them, so we're a little bit limited in that, but then use Rinpoche's comments on some of these topics to help us to move beyond. Another book that, again, you might find really useful is Rinpoche's book on how to practice Dharma. That's Teachings on the Eight Worldly Dharmas, which of course is going to be what we're going to talk about next week. This was published by Lama Yeshe Wisdom Archives, but it's not one of their free books. It was one that they asked for a donation of like $10 for, very minimal. And you can order it from them and they will be happy to send it to you. Or once more, you can get that as a ebook and read it that way. But I'm going to again cite from there as well when I can, because this is one of the most important topics of this book, because as was pointed out today, this is how we actually are practicing Dharma, is by letting go of this life, letting go of our attachment to this life. And as Rinpoche was saying, he saw that very clearly when he first read this text and recognized that he needed to change things in order for his life to be about truly practicing Dharma. And that's my hope, is for this course to at least get to a place where we can acknowledge that that step has to be taken and maybe feel a bit more committed to making that step, to actually, you know, moving away from our preoccupation with this life. So, all right, let's go ahead and do the prayers, Anil. If you could put those on the screen, we'll do our dedication prayers. So again, we're going to dedicate with the verse that essentially is making sure that all of the positive potential that we've created will be dedicated for our own enlightenment and the enlightenment of all beings. And then we're also going to think about that mind of bodhicitta that is the essence of that wish to benefit all sentient beings. And, I'm sorry, we're doing different prayers. I always get these confused. These are fine. We'll be doing these from Master Shantideva's texts. Can scroll to those. Yeah. And, as we do these, we have the same sorts of thoughts that everything that we do will become of the greatest benefit for all sentient beings, and especially for those that we're holding in our hearts right now, those whose suffering moves us, who are experiencing problems, difficulties, who are experiencing illness, who are dying or who have died. But we extend those wishes for those beings out to all sentient beings as we recite this prayer together. May all beings everywhere plagued by sufferings of body and mind obtain an ocean of happiness and joy by virtue of my merits. May no living creature suffer, commit evil, or ever fall ill. May no one be afraid or belittled with a mind weighed down by depression. May the blind see forms and the deaf hear sounds. May those whose bodies are worn with toil be restored on finding repose. May the naked find clothing, the hungry find food. May the thirsty find water and delicious drinks. May the poor find wealth, those weak with sorrow find joy. May the forlorn find hope, constant happiness, and prosperity. May there be timely rains and bountiful harvests. May all medicines be effective and wholesome prayers bear fruit. May all who are sick and ill quickly be freed from their ailments. Whatever diseases there are in the world, may they never occur again. May the frightened cease to be afraid, and those bound be freed. May the powerless find power, and may people think of benefiting each other. For as long as space remains, for as long as sentient beings remain, until then, may I too remain to dispel the miseries of the world. Then we do the prayers for our teachers. The following prayers are for three specific teachers, His Holiness Lama Zopa and Tenzin Osohita, who is Lama Yeshe's reincarnation. But extend this out to all the gurus, all the spiritual guides that exist in whatever tradition, so that we and others can continue to have them in this world, helping us and others on our path to full awakening. The wish-granting, wish-fulfilling jewel, source of every single benefit and happiness in this world, to the incomparably kind Tenzin Gyatso, I beseech, may all your holy wishes be spontaneously fulfilled. And for Rinpoche, you who uphold the subduer's moral way, who serve as the bountiful bearer of all, sustaining, preserving, and spreading Manjuna's victorious doctrine, who masterfully accomplish magnificent prayers honoring the three jewels, savior of myself and others, your disciples, please, please live long. And then lastly, for again Lama Yeshe's reincarnation, Venerable One, to you whose kindness exceeds that of all the conquerors, for those wanderers in far-off places, especially the West, mindful of your loving concern for us, in intentionally descending again into a family of a far distant land, we make this request. O Lama, please, please live long. And thank you all for being here today and for staying a little bit later. I realize I did go a little bit over, but I appreciate everyone being at these teachings, and I hope you all stay safe and healthy, and I'll see you again soon.